कभी करती हैं मुलाकातें, कभी करती हैं मुलाकातें, कभी यादों में बरसातें, किताबें करती हैं बातें, किताबें करती हैं बातें। मन की गहरी झील में कूद जाती हैं कभी, सोच के दरिया के संग संग बहती जाती हैं कभी, चाहे शाम हो या हो रातें, किताबें करती हैं बातें।
किताबनामा बुक्स एंड बियॉन्ड पे आपका बहुत बहुत स्वागत है, और आपका स्वागत बहुत है क्योंकि आपकी अभी नई किताब निकली है, लद्दाख नोइंग द अननोन। इट्स अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग टाइटल, सो प्लीज टेल अस समथिंग अबाउट इट।
माय थॉट प्रोसेस वाज दैट हाउ टू डू जस्टिस टू द मिस्टिसिज्म इन लद्दाख। इट इज़ द लैंड ऑफ मिस्ट्री एंड मिस्टीक, सो आई थॉट दैट यू नो ऑल ऑफ अ सडन इन अ फ्लैश ऑफ मोमेंट इट केम टू मी दैट इट इज़ लाइक ट्राइंग टू नो द अननोन, सो आई नेम्ड इट एज लद्दाख Knowing the Unknown.
I think we need to introduce you, although I think you are very well known in Delhi. You know, you are a multi-talented artist. You are a painter, you are a poet, you are a writer, you are a photographer, you are a filmmaker, and above all, you are a very senior civil servant. You hold a responsible position as Income Tax Commissioner. So how do you manage to combine all this, such diverse fields and diverse areas of interest?
Sushmanji, God is kind to me, and it is simply the divine's grace that I am able to do so many things. But nevertheless, I find that all creative aspects, they cannot be into compartments. If we take a holistic view of creativity, poetry is very akin to painting. Painting is very close to good photography when you can see good composition. And photography is a must for making a good documentary film. So all are interrelated, and I enjoy all aspects. In fact, now these days I am very excited about making films, because there all your faculties are used. Your poetry comes to your help, your photography comes to your help, your painting aspects and sense of composition also comes there. So in a way, all creative aspects are together, and I am very passionate about the whole thing, so I dabble into all.
Your book is an assimilation of your talent in all these art forms. Please share us a little bit of what you have to say about your own book.
मुझे लगा मैं जब वहाँ गई थी तो हम 17-18 आर्टिस्ट वहाँ पे साथ थे, और जब मैंने लद्दाख को देखा तो मुझे लगा कि इसका एक एक फ्रेम तो पेंटिंग है। सो यू नो पेंट तो मैंने वहाँ किया ही, पेंटिंग्स बनाई, मगर साथ साथ मुझे लगा कि अगर मैं इसको कम फोटोग्राफ कर लूँ तो शायद कुछ अलग बात बनेगी। पहले तो मैंने इसको फोटोग्राफ इसलिए किया था कि मुझे लगा कि इसके कलर्स ऐसे हैं कि मैं कहीं पेंटिंग में उसको यूज़ करूँगी, पर जैसे जैसे मेरा स्टे वहाँ पे लंबा होता गया, मुझे लगा कि लद्दाख इज़ कॉलिंग मी, यू नो आई हैव टू डू समथिंग, आई हैव अ रिलेशनशिप विद दिस प्लेस, एंड आई फेल्ट वेरी कनेक्टेड टू नेचर। एक पूरे यूनिवर्स आप उससे अपना एक संबंध स्थापित हुआ। आप देखेंगे कि इस किताब में मैंने वहाँ के लोगों को ज़्यादा नहीं दिखाया है, बिकॉज मुझे लगा कि वहाँ के लोग हैं, यूनिक हैं, उनकी डिस्टिंक्ट फीचर्स हैं, दे मेक वेरी गुड पिक्चर्स, बट उसके बारे में बहुत सारी बातें हो चुकी हैं, बहुत सारी किताबों में उनके बारे में लिखा गया है। उनकी ज्योग्राफी हिस्ट्री को छोड़ के मैंने नेचर को उसके मोस्ट मैग्नीफाइड फॉर्म में, मुझे लगा कि कितना विराट है ये प्रकृति का ये सौंदर्य यहाँ पर, शायद इसीलिए इसको रूफ ऑफ द वर्ल्ड कहते हैं। कि उसके बाद अगला स्टेप आपको लगता है कि यू आर कनेक्टेड, सेल्वेशन कहीं और दूसरे हेवन में जाना नहीं है, सेल्वेशन मेरे लिए मोक्ष का मतलब है अपने आप से मिलना, और आपका अपना जो है वो पूरे यूनिवर्स से अगर जुड़ा हो, कहीं प्रकृति से जुड़ा हो, तो वो वही वही वाली फीलिंग वहाँ पे आती है। इसलिए मैंने इसको एक अननोन टेरेन को खोजने की कोशिश की है इस किताब में।
हाउ मच टाइम डिड यू स्पेंड देयर इन लद्दाख? वॉज इट ऑल ड्यूरिंग वन ट्रिप और डिड यू मेक मोर देन वन ट्रिप?
जब मैं पहली बार गई तो वहाँ पे 2 हफ्ते थी, पर कैमरा हर समय दिन रात मेरे हाथ में रहता था। मैं कैमरे को लेके भी सो जाती थी कि सुबह कोई शॉट मुझसे ना छूट जाए। दोबारा मुझे मौका मिला जाने का। मैं हेमिस मॉनेस्ट्री के ऊपर एक आर्टिकल कर रही थी कुंफू नंस के बारे में, तो उन्होंने मुझे बुलाया तो मैंने कहा कि चलो और जो कुछ बचा हुआ आस्पेक्ट है उसको भी कवर कर लेंगे। दूसरी बार भी मैं 10-12 दिन थी। समय से ज़्यादा मेरे लिए ये ज़रूरी है कि मैं 24 घंटे लद्दाख को जीने की कोशिश कर रही थी थ्रू द फोटोग्राफ्स। पेंगोंग भी 2 बार जाना हुआ, तो हर बार जब आप लद्दाख अलग अलग समय में जाते हैं, मान लीजिए कि आपका गैप 1-2 महीने का भी है, लद्दाख बदल चुका होता है, तो वो उसकी खूबसूरती हर मौसम में अलग होती है।
आपको लगता है कि लद्दाख में जो पंच तत्व हैं उनका जैसे समन्वय हुआ पड़ा है, उसकी जो दृश्य हैं, उसकी जो लैंडस्केप हैं, माउंटेन्स, रिवर्स, हमारे कल्चर से इट्स लिंक टू आवर सिविलाइजेशन, इज दैट समथिंग यू ट्राई टू कैप्चर इन योर वर्क?
यस, डेफिनेटली। आई वॉज बिकॉज आई एम बेसिकली एन एब्स्ट्रैक्ट पेंटर, मैं 5 तत्वों पे ही काम करती हूँ, पृथ्वी, वायु, जल, आकाश, अग्नि, तो मुझे लगा कि मैं तो उनको उनके बेस्ट फॉर्म में वहाँ देख रही हूँ, मोस्ट प्योर फॉर्म में देख रही हूँ, अपनी सारी खूबसूरती और अपनी विराटता में वो सारे तत्व वहाँ मौजूद थे। मैंने अलग अलग चैप्टर किया हुआ है, एक चैप्टर मेरा क्लाउड्स के ऊपर है, एक चैप्टर मेरा सिंधु नदी के ऊपर है। तो जैसे हम इतना सब कुछ जानते हैं कि संगम है जहाँ पे गंगा, यमुना और सरस्वती मिलती है, वहाँ पे जंस्कार रिवर का जो कॉन्फ्लुएंस है वो इतना सुंदर है, इतना सुंदर है, 2 डिस्टिंक्टली डिफरेंट कलर्स, तो वहाँ भी एक संगम है। और हम बचपन से स्कूल में पढ़ते थे सिंधु घाटी की सभ्यता, इंडस वैली सिविलाइजेशन, तो वहाँ जाके जब आप सिंधु नदी को देखते हैं तो एक आपका एक अलग संबंध उससे स्थापित होता है। सिंधु नदी के रहने के कारण ही लद्दाख के लोग जीवित हैं, नदियों से ही उनका नो। मैं अपनी फिल्मों में बार बार नदी के ऊपर बहुत एम्फेसिस डालती हूँ, क्योंकि मुझे लगता है कि नदी का इंसान से जो रिश्ता है, उसके जन्म से मृत्यु तक, जन्म पे भी कुछ सेरेमनीज होती हैं जहाँ हम नदी के पास जाते हैं, और हमारे मृत्यु तक नदी से हमारा गहरा रिश्ता है, तो वो रिश्ता जब सिंधु नदी है तो उससे लगता है कि हाँ यहीं से तो हमारी शुरुआत हुई थी। और वहाँ पे एक फेस्टिवल होता है जिसको कहते हैं सिंधु फेस्टिवल, और वो बड़ा यूनिक इस सेंस में है कि लोग वहाँ पे नदी की पूजा करते हैं और सारे धर्मों के लोग वहाँ पे इकट्ठे होते हैं, और वो कहते हैं कि ये सारे धर्म आपके इस नदी का आवाहन करते हैं, क्योंकि हमारी सभ्यता यहाँ से शुरू हुई है और हम इसी के माध्यम से यूनिवर्स से कनेक्टेड रहें। तो वो भी बहुत इम्पॉर्टेंट आस्पेक्ट है। मुझे लगा कि सारे धर्म गुरु एक साथ कहीं इकट्ठे ही नहीं होते, सिंधु के तट पे इकट्ठे होके और सिंधु घाटी की पूजा करते हैं, तो वो अपने आप में बहुत यूनिक लगा मुझे।
बिसाइड स्पिरिचुअलिटी, मिस्टिसिज्म इज अनदर फीचर और अनदर आस्पेक्ट दैट कम्स अलाइव इन दैट होल लैंडस्केप वेरी ब्यूटिफुली, इज दैट ऑल्सो समथिंग दैट इंस्पायर्ड यू, मिस्टिसिज्म एसोसिएटेड?
डेफिनेटली, I consider myself as a very spiritually inclined person. When you go to Ladakh, your spirit is awakened and immediately you feel a connect with the nature. So that is the beauty of Ladakh. In a very mystic manner, the land beholds you. You feel that you are part of that, and that's why you can't stop yourself from going to Ladakh time and again whenever you get the opportunity. Ladakh has a kind of mysticism, because even the nature, you know, even the geography where the snow meets the sand dunes, which is, you know, you will go crazy about it, you would feel like dancing there, you know, khushi se aadmi nachne lage, waisi wali jagah hai wo.
I know that you haven't you know, clicked many pictures of people because their dress is so beautiful, their costumes is so beautiful, their customs are so engaging, but you avoided it. Was there a deliberate decision? If so, was there a reason? Iska kuch karan tha?
I'll tell you, because I'm an abstract painter and I thought that about the people of Ladakh, you know, their jewelry, their dress, their costume, so much has been written and has been photographed. Most of the people go for the mundane things, you know, the vegetation, the geography, the history. I wanted to go beyond that. Those people are clicked many a time and they make very good pictures and they make a very good picture book also. But I thought that this has been done and enough has been done about it. Though I have clicked them, but I have used them in articles, not in this book, with a clear intention.
Did you have to do a lot of research? Aapko kafi kitabein padhni padi, kafi kuch janna pada iske bare mein, ya aap pehle se hi ye sab research kar chuki thi?
You know, unfortunately, very little is available about Ladakh. You know, if you Google Ladakh, it will be like a tourist spot. The distance from Leh to Elchi is this much. Elchi has some fresco paintings of Buddhism. Very little, very sketchy things are there. So I thought that I read everything, whatever was available to me. Some travelogues were there, but it was only from a tourist point of view. And I wanted to get into the spirit of that place. So when I went second time, I thought that, you know, whatever has been done is done. I'm not going to do costumes. I'm not going to do their way of life, their vegetation. Enough is done. So I will go for the purity of that place, you know, the connect. I have not clicked monasteries. Ladakh has 200 monasteries. Every house, you know, between two houses there is a gompa. They feel that, you know, whoever is born in Ladakh and goes to is no more would connect to the through the monastery or the gompa. So I thought that enough has been done on that. So you know, if you are doing a book, you have to do differently. And I also took the risk of doing a book of photographs, and there are so many excellent photographers in India who would have captured Ladakh like nobody's business. I thought that I have to look at Ladakh as a painter. So book has pictures, but it has somehow God has been kind that I could compose such pictures which are more like paintings.
Have the colors of Ladakh sneaked into your paintings? Will they do that?
Of course. The colors of Ladakh would, you know, they are in my eyes, in my heart. This is one place, there's immense possibility for a painter, for a photographer, for a poet, for a filmmaker. Ladakh has so much to offer.
What is very exciting about the book is the way you have knitted poetry with pictures. That is what makes it very exciting. Did you enjoy writing it or putting it that way?
Instead of writing the mundane thing that this is the mountain range, the height of the mountain is so much, this much is the altitude, I thought everybody can Google and read about it. So I have quoted Rumi, I have quoted Kabir, I have quoted Dalai Lama, I have quoted from Vedas, you know, I read Vedas and selected some slokas which are very, very close to, they are talking about mountain, they are talking about gods. When I did a chapter on prayer flags, that was really a big research on that, because mostly we have this feeling that the prayer flags have Tibetan prayers to God. In fact, they are invoking the universe, they are invoking the nature. It's about all five elements. And it was a great joy to me because I also work on five elements. Yeah. So I thought that these prayer flags are so close to my paintings. So everybody would relate to Ladakh in a way, you know, you want to. And Ladakh will still relate to you as a photographer, as a painter, as a poet, as a tourist. It is a very fascinating place. To even tourists.
Yeah, and as a gateway to Silk Route as well.
Yes.
Yeah.
And you know, some of the pictures, I have made a chapter on the old city. Okay. I went personally there and it was not easy to make way to the old city because the lanes are so thin. Wo hamari Delhi ke patli gali se bhi zyada patle the. Aur us gali ke andar na bakeries thi. जो तुरंत वो फ्रेश ब्रेड बना रहे थे और वहाँ लाइक यस एंड पीपल दे मेक लवली ब्रेड देयर एंड वो उसकी खुशबू मतलब जाती है ना उन गलियों के अंदर अंदर जाके आप देखोगे कि एक म्यूजियम बना रहे हैं वहाँ पे. सो ओल्ड लद्दाख हैज इट्स ओल्ड वर्ल्ड चार्म स्टिल दे हैव मेंटेन इट. न्यू लद्दाख ले इज लाइक बिकॉज ऑफ द टूरिस्ट नाउ दे आर सेलिंग क्रीम्स ऑफ एप्रिकॉट एंड थिंग्स लाइक दैट बट द ओल्ड लद्दाख मेंटेन्स इट्स चार्म. My book start with the gateway.
Okay.
The first page has a gateway from where the Silk Route was, the gateway to India.
Yes.
And so much was traded, so much was traded between the two worlds, you know, and there was a barter system where you could exchange things. It has a very fascinating aspect to that. I call that old city, Puratan Nagri.
And the fact that Dalai Lama wrote for your book, I think it's really amazing. You must have loved it. And I think it's like a blessing by him.
I'm blessed because Ladakh is a very favorite destination of Dalai Lama. I personally requested him. He said, I have to see the book in full. And if you have got the essence of it, because Ladakh is not a tourist destination, it has a spiritual connect. So if I find that essence of Ladakh is there, then I will be able to write, otherwise I may not write. Then I waited and so he wrote.
You got pass marks.
Yes, I got pass marks and the book is really blessed because he has written the foreword. And he says these pictures are not ordinary pictures, these are timeless. So coming from him, I feel very specially blessed.
Are you planning to make a film about Ladakh now?
I have already made a film on Ladakh.
You are
I have made a film where I am, where you know in my film you'll see people. Because I am talking about Kung Fu nuns. The Drukpa cult, you know, the monastery, that's Hemis Monastery. They had an annual festival of, which was the fifth annual festival. They had called me to do an article about Kung Fu nuns. They said, we want you to write an article about Kung Fu nuns, especially talking about the empowerment of women. The subject is very dear to me, so I specially flew to do that story. And while I was doing the story, I also shot the film. And you know, I want to send this message. If nuns don't want to get bullied from the monks, they learn Kung Fu, then why can't we teach Kung Fu in schools? Why a girl or a teenager or a woman should depend on others for self for defense? If they know the basics, at least to some extent they can defend themselves. So my film is called Kung Fu Nuns in Mystic Ladakh, and I am talking about women empowerment. You know, physically also, if you do Kung Fu, your concentration increases, you are more focused, you can meditate better. And if you meditate, you can also do Kung Fu. They are all interrelated.
Could you tell us a little bit about your best experience of Ladakh? Any amazing experience that you've had during the 2 weeks?
You know, while I was traveling from Leh to Pangong River, Pangong is a lake. Actually, it's not a river. Pangong became very popular because in the film Three Idiots, there's a scene on the lake. Everybody knows about Pangong. So when I reached there, I saw a restaurant called Three Idiots. I started laughing and I went to the restaurant to have some soup. The whole journey from Leh to Pangong, it's a very difficult journey. It takes about more than 4 hours to reach. And you are shivering with cold. And in between you get Changla. Changla is a place where, you know, it is completely snow clad. You can't stand there for more than 20 minutes. There's an army post, they give you some tea to drink, and then they say, please don't stay here for more than 20 minutes, otherwise you will become breathless. So the whole journey from Leh to Pangong is absolute beauty. I have seen mountains of golden color.
Wow.
You know, so I have never seen any mountain range which looks golden. When the sun rays fall on those mountain peaks which are very near Pangong, they are golden. And the river changes its color. You know, being an artist, and I am extremely fond of blue color. Most of my paintings are blue. Every shade of blue is there in that river.
Wow.
So that is the beauty of Ladakh. It enchants you. It seduces you. you would simply fall in love with that place.
Any moment, anything that, you know, when you felt hesitant, you know, अब तो नहीं होगा, बहुत हो गया, मुश्किल है, कभी ऐसा आपको लगा?
Initially, you know, when I was very discouraged for a moment because I showed my pictures to two photographers. One who saw the pictures, I'll not name him, he said, you know, these are not perfect photographs because you have done it with a particular angle and you need to work more. So I said that, but I was very convinced that I have done a good job as a painter, not as a photographer. So I went to another photographer, Avinash Pasricha. I said, Avinash, you are a very close friend. Don't give me any, you know, दिल बहलाने के लिए मत बोलना, वो बोलना जो सच है. तुम ये फोटोग्राफ्स देखो और मुझे बताओ कि मैं बुक करना चाहती हूँ, मैं करूँ या ना करूँ. नो अविनाश, आई होल्ड हिम इन वेरी हाई एस्टीम एज अ फोटोग्राफर. ही सेड, संगीता, ये फोटोग्राफर के बस की बात नहीं है, ये फोटोग्राफर कर ही नहीं सकता जो तुमने उसको, यू हैव गॉन बियॉन्ड अ फोटोग्राफर्स आई, एंड बिकॉज योर एंगल इज डिफरेंट. You are thinking as a painter, you are clicking as a painter, your composition is different. So do a book. This would be a different book.
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद संगीता जी, आप किताब नामा में आई, बुक्स एंड बियॉन्ड में आपने बातचीत हमसे की और हमें अपनी किताब के बारे में इतना कुछ बताया कि अब तो मुझे भी जाना है लद्दाख.
थैंक यू.
The book in each case is the same one, which normally in this book doesn't happen. We always have a different book for every different ailment, but you'll see why we decided to choose this novel to represent both ailments. So the cure is called Daughters-in-Law, and it's by Joanna Trollope. So this is the cure for being a mother-in-law. Ladies, please pause to consider. If you are a mother-in-law, do you at least attempt to defy the cliche? No one is good enough for your child, of course, but it's still a cliche. Are you loving and supportive of your son or daughter-in-law, however little you actually like them? Have you accepted them gracefully as they are, though you wouldn't have chosen them yourself? Do you endeavor to see things from their point of view, albeit mistaken, even taking their side against your own offsprings, even though your darling is always in the right, knowing that in the end, this will strengthen their marriage and indirectly help your precious child? Of the three mothers-in-law, we'll call them MILs, featured in Joanna Trollope's rigorous exploration of intergenerational in-law relationships, it's Rachel, the mother of three grown-up married sons, and MIL to Sigrid, Petra, and Charlotte, who has the longest list of destructive behaviors to her credit. An energetic, efficient, protective tiger mother when her sons were growing up, she has become a forceful, interfering, invasive, controlling old cow now that they're putting their own partners first. Charlotte's mother, Marnie, appears on the surface to be benign. She's generous and wants to help out the couple financially, but they soon realize there's a fine line between support and suffocation. If you have brought up your sons never to oppose your wishes, if you phone them repeatedly, if you insist that family gatherings are at your own house, and when they're not, you arrive with the food, if you interrupt their intimate conversations with offers of homemade cake, if you research potential house purchases on their behalf without their consent, if you expect your daughters-in-law to stay with your sons out of gratitude for the way you raised them and reject them when they don't, if you can't allow your daughters-in-law to keep their postnatal depression a secret when neither they nor your son want you to know about it, and if your response to a daughter-in-law's announcement of her pregnancy is, "You've only been married 10 minutes, couldn't you have waited?" If you know that you have committed one or more of these MIL sins, then we'd like you, please, to read this novel. Then recreate yourself as a second mother to your extra children. It is Sigrid's mother who provides a role model for this. She insists calmly that you can only let your adult children go successfully if you have interesting, absorbing work or some other creative outlet of your own, plus a strong enough relationship with your own partner, if you have one. Only then will you not go begging your children for the time and attention they should be giving their own families. Be loving, supportive, generous, understanding, kind, and fun. But don't have time to interfere. And then we say at the end, see also control freak being A, which is another ailment in the book that you could read another time.